comes from executive producer Lilian Garcia. Every athlete is on this quest. Every performer dives in head first, battling real life challenges and overcoming obstacles in an effort to make their dreams reality. Singer, speaker, and 15-year WWE host Lilian Garcia was the first woman to ever announce WrestleMania and is now the PFL MMA cage announcer. Oh, yeah. And now she's giving you an all-access pass to the human interest stories of elite athletes, extraordinary entertainers, and wellness experts. Now, let's embark on another fascinating journey of chasing glory with your host, Lilian Garcia.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Chasing Glory and congratulations. All right. Congratulations. And you're like, why congratulations? We survived another week. Woo-hoo! It's the small steps, right? It's those little steps, these little survivals every single day in this craziness that we are in. Oh, my God. Oh, but we're going to get through it. We're going to get through it. We're going to do it together. So I just want to congratulate you on that because it is right now a huge accomplishment just to get from one day to the next. But I hope that you're learning things along the way. And even in my freaking lows, and I'll tell you about some of those this week, I am learning some things and I am a little bit more fired up today because the cub that I felt like this week, because I'm a Leo, and I was telling my husband, I kind of feel like a cub right now. I'm turning into that lion again. And like I said, I'll tell you about that coming up. But we've got a lot to cover, so I want to go ahead and get right into it. It's very important, though, everything that I'm about to say, including the huge congratulations to Becky and Seth. Becky Lynch and Seth Rollins. They are having a baby. Woohoo! So excited. Oh, my God. What a huge thing and a monumental thing for both of them. And especially, I know it's hard for Becky because, you know, top of the game, champion, she had relinquished that. And, you know, it's kind of like one of those things when I was communicating with her in the fact that it can make you a little bit like, oh man, I'm giving up my career to have a baby. And maybe is this the right time or the fact that I have to give that up? But you know what I told her? I shared a story with her because I felt like it was very important for her to maybe have this in the back of her mind. And so I want to share it with you in case any women out there that are feeling like you have to choose between having a baby and having your career, take it from me. I waited a bit too long in the WWE. By the time I left to have a baby and I was like, okay, now's the time to have this baby. It was too late. Yep. My husband and I got told that waited too long and couldn't have a child. And that hit me really hard because I never thought that that was going to be taking away from me. And that the choice I thought was always going to be mine, whether the time was right to have it or not. And so I told Becky, guess what? This is the perfect time because you're able to have this child. And that's a huge gift. And that's something that I cannot have. And I said, you can always come back to wrestling later, but you can have it all. And that's what I didn't think I could have, is be able to step away from the WWE, have a child, and come back to my career. So, like I said, I wanted to share that in case any of you women out there are feeling like, well, I don't want to lose my career to have a child, but I feel like you can have both. And I didn't trust that. And I'm just so excited that she's trusting that and having this kid. And they're going to be amazing parents. So congratulations to the two of them. Also, a huge congratulations to last week's guest. Oh my God, we recorded the interview and also my opening before Money in the Bank. So the fact that he won Money in the Bank, woo-hoo, Otis, congratulations. And I know, now that you guys heard the interview, isn't he awesome? He's just this big teddy bear that you just want to squeeze. And I just love the fact, though, that he shared about, you know, the years that he was bullied and how that sometimes still stings, and then dealing with dyslexia still to today and how he handles that, and just some of the real things that he shared with us and the struggles, so that you could celebrate him and celebrate his accomplishments. And any of you that are out there experiencing that, you can actually know that you can become a champion in whatever you choose to do. So thank you, Otis. Thank you for being so real, raw, and inspiring. Okay, another huge accomplishment. Oh my God, guys, 7 million downloads. Woo! I hear the fireworks. Yes, I see the confetti. Woohoo! I'm so excited. Can you tell? We did this. We did this together. I can't do this without you. Okay, so thank you. 7 million downloads. That is a huge accomplishment. And you know, after the 100th episode, we went to video. So the fact that we're on video now is very exciting. So it's now not only a podcast, but a YouTube show thanks to you. Ah, man. And Chasing Glory has been through some ups and some downs too. And so to be real with all of you, wanted to let you know of something that we launched. We launched it last week, so excited that we launched it. Now I went through my own little triggers of being in fear before the launch, and I share that in a special thing that I'm about to tell you. But we launched this because we really wanted to create a win-win scenario. During this time, during the pandemic, I've lost a lot. I've lost a lot of opportunities, income, all of that because of things being canceled. So my team, and you know, my husband's part of the team, he's the president of Chasing Glory, we were having a meeting of how the heck do we keep Chasing Glory alive, because this is so important for us to bring this to you, and you're telling us how much it's helping you. So we wanted to create a platform that was a win-win. You've been asking for this, so we took the time to do it. We went in the vault and started gathering all of these never-before-seen footage that we had, and all of these live Q&As that we could create, and these concerts, and these live chats, and a place where you can help build Chasing Glory, and a place where you can get the episodes before they go live to anybody else, and a place where you can become a member and unlock so many goodies, and the speed, not speed round. That's a fun game that we now have on Chasing Glory, and you can get it. Okay, without further ado, if you haven't heard, Patreon. What? That's right. Okay, so some of you don't know what Patreon's all about. I didn't know what Patreon was until so many requests started coming in to build a Patreon page. So we did it. So it's patreon.com/Lilian Garcia. It is a membership program where you can get all these never before seen footage and all the goodies that come with it. And we made it super, super affordable and in a way that it helps Chasing Glory and keeps Chasing Glory alive. So that's the win-win, right? We give you all of this content and then you support with the membership. We made it as cheap as $2 and the most is $10. So guys, I think that is definitely a win-win, and I'm so excited that we had these members that immediately became a member, and I wanted to go ahead and acknowledge the first 10 members that signed up. Congratulations, or I should say thank you. Well, maybe congratulations, because they're going to get all this stuff. We got Aaron, Chris Keller, Liam Eversage, Tina Salvatore, Caitlin, Elizabeth Thiessen, Brandon Miller, Waylon Myers, Thomas Ott, James Epperson, and the number one person that signed up, Paul Lee. Thank you. So awesome. So immediately, they also reached out and they were like, oh my God, this is really cool, because they got all those little goodies and things get added every single week. It's so much fun. So check it out. Patreon.com/Lilian Garcia. Okay. So that is going to be something that we continue to celebrate and continue to pump in there. All right. So when we launched Patreon, another thing that's on there is called Lilian Garcia BST. It's bite-sized thoughts. And I release this bite-sized thoughts, and there are my things that I want to share with you. So in hopes of helping you in all the things that I've learned along my journey. And one of the things that I shared with you is how scared I was to launch Patreon. I don't want to tell you here because that's exclusive for members, so you can hear all about it there. But I will say that the day that we did launch Patreon, I finally came around and I was so happy. And I was on cloud nine. And my husband and I were walking and we were just like, oh my God, yay, we did it, we launched it. And then came back from the walk and got some information that blew our mind. Why? Because I feel like during this time, you're gonna get, or you're gonna see the best in people, and then you're also going to get and see the worst in people. Well, the letter and the email that we got from our place, because we do rent, and that is a choice that my husband and I made, because we owned before and didn't really like owning, so we decided to rent, and that's a whole nother story. But where we rent, we also have this Chasing Glory studio, and it's very, very special, especially now. The fact that everybody was like, stay at home, thank goodness we could still bring Chasing Glory live to you because we didn't have to leave our home. It is part of it. So the fact is, though, our rent or our lease is up. So we have a rent renewal negotiation that we're going through. Well, we didn't think that they were going to even attempt to raise the rent, but indeed they have. They want to increase it by 6%. Ugh, what? Do they not know that there is a worldwide pandemic going on, that so much loss of income that has happened? We've been straightforward with them. We have also proven to them all the loss of income, even PFL. PFL is gone for me. So there's a lot that we're dealing with and trying to keep the show alive, and we've been upfront with them, but nope, they don't care. And they said 6% or you can vacate. Well, guys, we went on a freaking low. We were so bummed out. We were so upset. I think what really hurt us is to know that there's people out there with so much greed. Greed during this time. I mean, greed is never good, never. But during this time, it's the lowest thing you can do. So I do want to bring this up. If you guys are in a position of helping people, please help people. Don't be in a position of greed, okay? I promise you, it will come back. Karma is great. When you do good, karma is amazing. When you do not do good, oh, karma's bad. And trust me, I've seen it time and time again, how karma will get you. Well, we are going to take these people to the mat. We're gonna fight for our rights to not get this increase. I mean, it's kind of crazy that they're even asking for this. But we are surrounding ourselves with reaching out to friends that might know lawyers, reaching out to friends that might have solutions, you know, everything that we can empower ourselves with, just reaching out to friends for like a shoulder to cry on, you know, anything that helps. So if you're in the same situation, in this same boat, fight. Fight, fight, fight. Do not allow this to happen to you. So again, the Patreon page helps to keep Chasing Glory alive, especially during this time. So we thank you for that. And we will keep you updated as to what happens with the outcome of our lease to keep this studio that has meant so much to us because of everything that it has brought to you. And your reviews help let us know about that. So speaking of the reviews, told you guys that we were starting the contest again with the reviews on Apple Podcasts because that also helps the show. And I love reading these reviews. It's just great to hear how the show is impacting you, especially because so many times, or I should say all the time, I'm in a room talking to myself and I'm talking to you, but I don't see you and I don't feel you. So sometimes I'm like, hello, anybody out there? Your reviews let me know that yes, it is reaching you. And it makes me really, really happy, and the team as well. So the contest is back. Leave a review. If you get chosen as the review for the week, you get put into the drawing for the month. And so this week's winner, drum roll please. Okay, Legit Dub. Ooh, love that name, Legit Dub. Okay, 5 stars. Thank you for that. I have always been a huge fan of Chasing Glory. Lilian has impressed me with her announcing skills. Aw, thanks. And hearing so many superstars, personalities, and people's chase to glory is nothing short of inspiring, especially on days when you're feeling in the dumps. Hearing a great chase to glory story is the perfect way to flip your mood. Absolutely. Lilian does a great job picking apart people's stories and digging deep into what set them on the right path. Easily in my top three favorite podcasts. Thank you. And Lil, we are going to get through this lockdown together. We sure are. Thank you for taking the time to do this show, especially during now. Can definitely see how this is like a therapy session for you and your listeners alike. Thanks again. Oh man, legit dub. You said it. It is a therapy session for sure. I need you guys as much as you need the show. I need you. So again, thanks for everything. And I wanted to, bring this special episode to you. So one of the things that we're doing, and I told you, life right now, you got to learn how to pivot in your jobs, in your careers, in your everything. Just learn how to pivot. If life is throwing you a curveball here, go this way. Okay, so one of the things that we're doing is we're going into the vault. We're going into the vault more and more to get these classic episodes that you might have missed the first time around. And sometimes even if you heard them the first time around, you can always hear it with a different ear the second time around and get a different lesson out of it. I sure did. So the fact that it's Mental Health Awareness Month, which is very, very important, especially during this time because suicide rate is on the rise, makes me so sad. And I want to say right now, if you are thinking out there of suicide, please hold on. I know that things can feel very heavy, especially now, but no, you're not alone. We're all going through this. And no matter how much you might see still on Instagram, people TikToking and the dancing and all, that's them trying to feel better, because when those cameras come off, man, so many of them reach out to me because I'll see their pages, and then they reach out to me and they're like, man, I'm down in the dumps. And I'm like, yeah, I am too. But it's trying to also do something to make you feel better. So you're not alone. But if you need some help, 24/7, there are centers out there. And right now I'm going to give you the number for one. It's the National Suicide Prevention Center hotline that confidentially you can call and they can help you. 1-800-273-8255. 1-800-273-8255. Give them a call and they will help you as to how you can handle your feelings. Because man, feelings can be great, and then feelings can bring you down. But breathe. You can make that shift. Okay? You can make that shift. So the reason we brought this classic back is because Melina was a guest on my show, but she was a guest when we were still doing just audio. I had her filmed on video, but because we weren't doing the YouTube show, it never aired. So we thought, guess what? It is the perfect time to do a Run It Back classic. Bring her on here when she talks about the fact that she attempted suicide. I don't know if many of you know that or not, but she was so open about it in this episode, and we wanted to bring it to you because she talked about how she was able to overcome that attempt. And again, it's important to hear from people that have been through it. And so for Mental Health Awareness Month, Melina, thank you. Thank you for being so open. And now you guys can see it. You can go to youtube.com/Lilian Garcia or just go to chasingglory.com. It is very easily accessible there. You can also, again, always hear it wherever you get your podcast. But Melina, thank you. Thank you for being open. And guys, just thank you for everything, including the 5 stars and including that 7 million downloads. Let's keep it going. Okay, here we go. Here is the Run It Back Classic with Melina on Chasing Glory. Although she would consider herself a simple person with a simple life, Melina has accomplished some extraordinary things in her lifetime. Born and raised in Southern California, Melina Perez would become an accomplished beauty pageant contestant, winning Miss Hawaiian Tropic Anaheim and Miss California Belleza Latina.
But she knew she was meant for more of a physical lifestyle. So Melina would try her hand at pro wrestling by enrolling in Jesse Hernandez's school of hard knocks and quickly fell in love with it. Her natural ability would make her a standout, and she even tried out for the third season of WWE Tough Enough. Although she didn't make the final cut, it pushed her even further to make it to the WWE. She would make sporadic appearances as an extra for the WWE and would eventually be signed to a full-time contract in early of 2004. She would report to Developmental, where she would link up with Johnny Nitro and Joey Mercury and form the unforgettable trio known as MNM. They would make their main roster debut on SmackDown, and in the spring of 2005, they made an immediate impact where she led the team to winning the WWE Tag Team Championship. In addition to being in the corner of the team, Melina would compete in the women's division, facing off some of the best divas that the WWE had to offer. Melina would soon dominate the women's division, beating Mickie James for the WWE Women's Championship, and even retained her championship in the first ever Women's Falls Count Anywhere match in the WWE. After also winning the WWE Divas title, Melina became the first woman to win the Women's and Divas Championship multiple times. Melina would leave the WWE in 2011, but would continue wrestling on the independent scene, competing all over the world. She would mix it up with many of the past and future WWE superstars, and still cultivating wrestling fans throughout the globe. She continues to compete on the indie circuit while providing the veteran leadership that she can offer. It's no wonder, while multiple Hall of Famers have called her one of the best women wrestlers to have ever stepped in the ring. It's about to get real, raw, and inspiring with Melina.
And here she is. I am so excited for this. Melina, welcome to Chasing Glory.
Happy.
Oh man, you're tearing up as you hear that bio. Tell me what you're feeling.
Because I don't know, it's sometimes like you realize like the things you've done and people forget that you're human, you know? So to hear the things that I've accomplished when going through it, it didn't feel like I was doing a lot of stuff. It just felt like I'm just doing me and doing what I needed to do. And sometimes it seems like it's worth nothing and nobody sees you for who you are, who you wanted to be. So when you hear stuff like that, it's like, wow, I did something.
Yeah.
It's kind of nice.
I hear you, because I realized it too. I told that to somebody when I was doing an interview. They were reading off some of the things that I'd done, and I was like, wow, I never gave myself a moment to appreciate it or take it in or be like, yes, you did this, girl. And that's why I encourage that so much now, right? It's when you do something, I don't care if it's the smallest thing, take a moment to be like, hell yes.
Yes, it's okay to give those moments and then give yourself a little pat on the back. Like, you know, okay, I did well. But sometimes it's just like, go, 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 go.
And yeah. Then,
or survive, like survival mode, and you just can't look back. But you don't realize that some of these moments are the best moments of your life until afterwards.
Right. I want to go ahead and let people know that it's so funny. We're basically both in New York, but we're too far from each other in New York. So I'm here in Long Island. I am, you know, taping this as being part of the PFL MMA and getting ready for that on ESPN. And then I hear that you're in Brooklyn.
Yes.
Long Island and Brooklyn might as well be, you know, freaking LA to New York. The traffic is so hard. Like, yeah, our schedules and all. What are you doing in Brooklyn?
I'm hanging out. I'm hanging out with Rick Taldo.
Oh, that's awesome. Just hanging.
So I was in Baltimore and I'm going to Philly. So I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go hang out with Rick.
Oh, that's great. That's great. So now you're still wrestling. You're still doing indies?
Yes. Yeah. Just every so often, nothing too crazy.
How is that for you after leaving WWE? Like, you doing that?
It is. It's interesting because like there's some moments where, because the reason I wanted to do it was because I'm not done with it yet, but then at the same time, it's like, I wanted to give back and see, you know, just be a part of like the future of wrestling, to see like what's out there. Like, it makes me happy to see the passion in these kids and to see what they're gonna, like what they're capable of now and what they're gonna do in the future. So I'm just, it makes me love wrestling, like stay with the love of wrestling. Wow. So I'd see this and it's really great to be able to be a part of this and see this. But then there are moments where it's like, I don't know, it kind of, sometimes it still breaks my heart. Where yeah. It just, some people appreciate, like, I had this one girl, and she's so sweet. She had me meet her parents and everything, and her parents told me about the impact that I had on her. And I just started crying, because, like, that's the stuff that means a lot to me. If a person looks up to me, and I'm able to, you know, to teach them something, or to fulfill something, like they got to wrestle a person that they looked up to, like, that means a lot to me. That's my way of saying, I love you. And thank you for everything. Like, this, me, they're my kids. I told them I may not have children, but these kids in wrestling that watched me and they're somehow inspired by me.
Yeah.
Those are my children, and I want the best for them, and I want to see them do it and accomplish so many great things in life. So that means so much to me. But then you'll meet the people who they're still people, and they're human, that have disrespect. And it's like, that hurts my heart, where I'm like, wow, well, I'm sorry you feel that way, but, you know, I wish you could see that I just want nothing but the best for you.
What is it that you think people are seeing that turns them into having disrespect?
I think it's a multitude of things. Like, it's them being insecure, because it's still, as much as we are all pro women, supporting women, it still hasn't reached a certain level yet that I would like to see, or in my lifetime before. Like, yeah. I would love to see it for, I guess for me, because I haven't felt that. I feel like we learned all these lessons after the fact. So now, like, our era, like, we were grouped, now we're like unified and we're great.
Right.
But at the same time, in an environment that kind of didn't let us be that, or maybe we felt like we couldn't be that, the newer generation has that now. You can be friends with each other. You can support each other. It's not about one person in wrestling. It's about each other. I can't do something without you. I need you and you need me. We need each other. And it's a great sisterhood. But now we still have women. I'm sorry if you hear the...
Yeah, good old...
New York.
Like I said, New York.
We still have, like... Because back in the day, there weren't a lot of women. So it's like you were one person, one female amongst a locker room of men. So it was hard to kind of support each other. But now everybody's there in it together. And yeah. I guess what they see with me is they're still a little bit threatened. They're either threatened because, I don't know, maybe it's this certain presence that I have. Some people say I'm intimidating by the way I look, or the way I carry myself, or because I was in the WWE, so I'm intimidating. I do nothing, but I try to give hugs. I try to make people feel welcome, but sometimes it's just something within them that they can't let go of. Right. Sometimes they see that maybe I'm my character, and in their mind, they see me as Melina, the character, and that there's nothing else. They can't see the actual person that's in front of them.
It's funny that you say that, because when I met you, I knew you were coming and all of that kind of stuff. And I did have this kind of persona. And then when I met you and you were so sweet, I have to tell you, Melina, at first I'm like, is this an act? Is this an act? Yeah, no, seriously.
I've gotten that a lot too.
Because you're so nice and people are typically not that nice that sometimes it came off with, is this an act to be so nice that I let my guard down? And then it's like, gotcha. So
yeah.
Why do you feel like maybe you say you've gotten that? So tell me about that.
Oh, somebody has told me that. Like I went through a long time where I didn't understand why I was, like, people were weird with me. But somebody told me, like, blatantly said, you know what? You're so nice. It can't be real. And I was just like, what? And then they told me, yeah, it comes off as fake. And I was like, wait, what? Because I've seen fake. I understand what fake is. Yeah. But when, I guess I could see when you're in an environment where probably, because it's all the, like, I get it. I get it when it comes to them, what they've went through. So what they've seen. So they probably trusted somebody and opened up their heart to somebody or befriended somebody and they were nice and they thought they were nice. And then all of a sudden it was abused.
Yeah.
I, the way I grew up was we were all family. So I just grew up from being with my family to going to what I thought was my wrestling family and being just as open as I ever was, but like in my quiet way, because I was shy. I get another reason why people thought I was the way I was because I didn't talk a lot. So I get that because I didn't open up that they questioned that.
Yeah.
But I opened up in ways where I'm just like, I hug people and I just want to be helpful, to serve a purpose by being helpful, but I never really said much because I just watch.
Right.
But I get people got closed off by that. But I'm also just a, like, I trust people because I think everybody's good because I was always around my family. That's all I've ever known.
Yeah, let's talk about that. I want to get to know you as a kid. I want to get to know you. I mean, I just mentioned it, how you're a California girl.
Yeah, but people, I think people also have a different view on what California person is too, because they think Hollywood. But back in our day, like, say my parents, there was like, okay, so let me just lay down the foundation of who my family is. My parents were teenagers when they had me. So my mom was 15 when she had my brother and 19 when she had me.
Wow.
So they were kids raising kids.
Yeah.
So we didn't have much. So I'm pretty proud of my parents, like, because they decided to move out on their own as teenagers and just handle everything themselves. I couldn't even imagine doing that. I'm an adult and I'm still like, oh my goodness.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
So I'm like, how did they do it as children, to have children and move out on their own and handle business? So we didn't have much and we didn't mind, like, we didn't care that we didn't have anything, that we didn't have all the toys. We had hand-me-downs. We had, like, you know, go to yard sales and whatnot. Like, it didn't, in that point of time, it wasn't a big deal to not have
designer
clothes. Yeah. And yeah, if we wanted candies and we couldn't have it, it's like, well, no, you can't have that. Oh, okay. So all we cared about was that we had each other.
Yeah.
That our love, like family love and family being there, was everything, that we didn't know that we were missing out on anything.
So when did it come a little bit later on in life that it was like, oh, there is another whole life of having things?
I guess it was high school, because it was important for my mother to have me be in nice clothes all of a sudden. I guess for my senior year especially, it was just like, we need to have Calvin Klein this and that. And I was like, what? Okay, like, whatever. I was just happy that my mom was happy. So I'm like, okay. So I admit, it, even though I was educated, I guess, in a way where it was, we were taught to, like, let's move away from, like, the ghetto parts of life. Like, my parents did everything we could to get away from, like, let's move from Southgate, which was, like, not so great area. Let's go from this area to this. And we moved and moved and moved until we went away from, like, you know, ghetto and gang life. So my parents did whatever it could to give us a better opportunity for what to have what they never had. And in high school, my mom started, like, looking for designer clothes. And that's the only time the light bulb clicked, like, oh, this is nice. Yeah. But it was never really that important, because I guess I still kept thinking in my mind, I just want my family to be happy. That's it.
Yeah.
If they're happy, I'm happy.
So what were some of the struggles then that you endured as you were growing up in that lifestyle? Was it the amount of moving? Were there spats? Were there, like, what's your normal struggles that you were enduring?
No, the weird part is my, and this is why I think, like, my viewpoint, I'm very lucky. I was always happy no matter what. So we didn't have much. Like, Christmas was, we're lucky we got socks. So that was just like, but my perception was, again, I have my family. So then everything was great. Like, we would live in garages and whatnot, like converted garages. So we didn't have anything. So everything that we did was support each other. Like, our suffering was okay as long as we had each other.
And that's the four of you.
Yeah. So it was my brother and me, my mom and dad. So I was lucky to have a dad that stuck around. Like, I am blessed to have a dad that cared. Like, he would do stuff like, okay, I love and respect my dad like nobody's business. When people say women have father issues, not a problem here.
Yeah, me neither. Anything,
yeah. If anything, he set a bar where this is the way men can be. And so that's what I'm like, oh, he's just so amazing. He would make sure, like, I didn't realize, because of the way I perceive life.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that we didn't have a lot of money for food. So my dad would make sure that he wouldn't eat. He would just wait until everybody got fed.
Wow.
And so he'd sit there and he'd wait. And when we would eat, and then he'd wait until the end, and then he finally ate, because he'll just eat whatever's left over. So things like that is just like, my dad was just amazing. If we were struggling, he'd find a way. He would make sure he'd try to do whatever he could to make sure that we were okay. As long as there's a roof over our head and we got fed and he's there, that's all that mattered.
So that's impressive. I love that. That's great. So how was it for you when you went to school? Because with that perception, there he is again. Excuse me, we're having an interview. No, God bless whoever is needing that ambulance right now.
Yes, right? I always think whenever I hear that, I always do like a little prayer. I'm like, may they get there as soon as they can.
Yes, for sure. I always do the sign of the cross for sure. All right, so, but with that perception, right? And you're not one of those that have been really struggling with your environment because you don't really know any better. You have parents that are so loving. Then you go to school. Or go ahead, tell me.
School was extremely important. Like, my parents made sure that education was everything. So I did whatever it could. Like, I stayed in my room. I was like the way my mom puts it, she was the perfect child. I was like, was I, mother? But I would just go home, do my work, do my schoolwork, do my schoolwork. But I mean, in our day, you could tell that race was a thing. As much as people are like, no, nobody ought to suffer. My parents suffered worse than what I had to suffer. I'm lucky that time started changing as I was growing up. But I would sit, like, we would go places, like, say, a pizza place. Like, we'd go to Little Caesars at the time. I'd sit somewhere, and the lady next to me wouldn't want to sit next to me because I was, like, a disgusting, you know, dark child. At that time, because I played it out, because, say, me being Latin, if I'm out of the sun, I lighten up. If I'm in the sun, I get really dark.
Yeah.
But same here. I remember moments like that where people didn't want to be near me because it's like, ew. And then I would think, I didn't understand, but my mom would just hug me. And I was like, oh, everything's okay. And then I remember dolls. I never found dolls that looked like me. Usually they were blonde. And I remember when Cabbage Patch Kids came out, the biggest thing ever, because you could actually get a doll that looked like you. And that was just the biggest deal in the world, where, wow, this one has a tan like me too, and it has dark hair.
Yeah.
And it had brown eyes. The fact that it had brown eyes, I was like, oh my God.
Right. You know, I didn't even think of that. Of course I wouldn't think of that. But of course it would affect you. Absolutely.
Oh, it did. Like, Wonder Woman, that's why Wonder Woman was also a big deal for me, because she was the only I'm not saying that there wasn't any other dark-haired women on TV, but for some reason, she was the only one that I saw in, like, TV shows that were, like, dark, dark hair like mine.
Yeah.
Like, I would watch, like, you know, 80s movie or movies, TV shows, and usually everybody's, like, lighter hair.
Yeah.
But she had black hair.
Right.
And I'd see her and think, wow, I want to be her.
How did you handle that? Like, how did it make you feel when that woman didn't want to sit next to you?
It made me feel like there was something, like, there's something wrong with me. Like, what was something wrong? Well, that's why I have, like, this, everybody will always compliment me, or they'll say, oh, you're pretty or you're cute. Well, I'm like, no, that doesn't matter to me. In my mind, I guess I have, like, maybe ugly duckling syndrome or something. I don't know how to describe or how to call it. But, I mean, it keeps me humble. So I think, like, okay, I never felt like I, either looks-wise, there's something, I'm not what people or society says I should have looked like. And I'm cool with that. Now as an adult, I'm good with that. I'm good with being a good person and a good soul. We're going to get older and our looks are going to change. It's always going to change. Like, we're not going to be what we once was. And I'm fine as long as the soul's good, as long as the heart and the intentions are good.
But
all that matters.
I love that you've processed that now, which is amazing. But I can also understand that the pain that comes with that when you're trying to figure it out and that you're not feeling pretty, and how that can actually also hurt you when you're even, you can't even accept a compliment.
Yeah. Oh, but that took years. That took years for that. I know it's like when I got older, then my teeth weren't really that great. And it's just all these things, like even in wrestling, like I couldn't understand when people would say, like the culture shock of wrestling, when people said I was pretty, it was just like, what? Okay. I don't get it, but whatever. Like that was probably that one person's perspective, or maybe they're just like not really looking at me, or they just would like anything. Like I couldn't accept any compliments. And somebody actually told me in high school, they're like, Melina, just accept the compliment. Cause I didn't realize that every time he was complimenting me, and it was a friend that lived in the neighborhood, he said, every time I'm trying to be nice to you and you just won't let me be nice. And I was like, oh, it didn't occur to me that I wasn't letting someone be nice.
Yes, because a lot of times we just want to throw it back because we're just like, oh, no, I'm not. And we don't realize how much damage we're doing to the person that's giving us the compliment.
Yes.
Instead of just saying, thank you so much, you know, even if you don't believe it. So that has to be hard, though. The fact that you picked a career that is based on not just talent, but it is also based on looks. So that had to be hard to pick a career and now be in a room full of other women that are so beautiful. Tell me how you process that.
Oh my goodness. Oh, now you're thinking of like all these things. It's so weird. You're making me actually realize how, I guess I never really came to terms with all that, like compliments and how I saw myself, until later. Cause I was always in denial. Like I'm thankful that everybody has different tastes. Everybody has different viewpoints of what's beautiful. And some people like dark, some people like light, you know what I mean? When it comes to skin or hair and whatever, some people love tall, some people love short. I've come, like now I love that that's all out there. People are very more expressive that they love variety, and it's okay to not look a certain way.
Right.
So I love all of this now. But back then I just told myself, like when I won my first contest, like that's what changed my world. I was supposed to be a medical assistant. I wanted to be a doctor.
Oh, so, wow.
So the medical field was everything to me. So that was
you and me both. That's where I was going. Well, we took a right turn from that one.
Didn't it? And that like really messed me up when I went into like entertainment. It was like, well, I'm not helping people. The fans made me realize I still chose a profession that helped people, just not in the way I thought.
Yeah.
So, but that contest changed my world because I saw myself as ugly for so long that that moment in time made me think, again, didn't say think physically. I'm like, oh my goodness, they picked me because they saw the inner beauty that shined out. That's what I told myself. That it was all about inner beauty, and people can see inner beauty through the way you carry yourself or the way you act.
Yeah.
So that's the way I felt. So it started making me brave to do contests, to do things that I've never tried before, to start losing my fear of everything. So whether it was about how people perceive me physically or how I saw myself, I needed to break out. Mm. So when I did wrestling, it to be amongst beautiful women, it was just like, wow. Like everybody's so beautiful here. Like everybody's so gorgeous. But what made me happy about being a part of that locker room was that now I'm a part of a group that loved what I loved, because wrestling wasn't something that, you know, girls liked. You're stupid or you're an idiot or you're weird if you like wrestling. Like amongst my female friends, they just thought I was the weird girl. It's like, Melina, when are you going to like real or, you know, normal things? Why are you so weird? I'm like, oh, sorry. They love me no matter what, but I was always the weird one.
Yeah.
So to be a part of the wrestling locker room, that was like, finally, I'm around other women who like what I like. And look at them, how pretty they are. And actually, that made me finally embrace my feminine side, where it was like, I never put on makeup. I never wore dresses, never wore skirts. It made me want to like dress up
yeah.
and embrace that side of me.
That's awesome. So you saw it as a positive, and you saw it as something to like embrace, but you were still okay with the fact that you weren't feeling pretty, but you were next to this pretty girl?
Yeah, because yeah. I guess me being the ugly duckling, I always felt like I have a knack for seeing the best in people, and everybody has something to contribute that I can't. And I was very secure when it came to that I had something to contribute that nobody else can.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Did you have a lot of friends in school?
It's like, yes and no. It's the weirdest thing. It's like people were always changing. So like the moving, I always found new friends, but then I'd make friends because I'm always the girl who, I guess if we all felt out of place, I found the people who felt like the way I did, we were all out of place together.
Mm. And you felt out of place because of your looks, because of your culture?
Because of the culture, I guess. Like, because yeah. It's so weird, even though there was a lot of Hispanics, like more Hispanics started coming in, but it was like sometimes I was the token and then I'd find other tokens. And it was like not only ethnic wise, but yeah. Even some people were the nerds and that everybody didn't like appreciate the nerds or even the goth kids or whatnot. Like everybody just felt out of place. We all were out of place together.
So that must have helped you, especially though, I'm thinking that it probably was hard because you moved around so much. As soon as you started creating friends, you had to go somewhere else.
Yeah, it was really painful because it's like I missed the people that understood me. Yeah. But then you find new people. And I guess because we're young, we're resilient. But still, I remember hurting each time I moved because I'd start crying because I'm like, I miss Stella. I miss this person. I miss Nikki. Like all these people. I'm like, oh, broke my heart.
Right.
And then again, well, no, you're right. Because then when I reached junior high, that's when it really hit that I would always find the outsiders and we'd hang out. But when I reached junior high and I was the new girl, everybody at that point in time had their cliques. And that point in time, the new girl was not only weird, but it's like, you don't belong anywhere.
Oh, wow. So
I think eighth grade was the hardest one for me at that point because nobody wanted to let me in.
So is that when you became more of like, you want to be isolated?
Oh, yeah. I totally did. Well, I just stuck to whatever I was doing and just, I think maybe I got even quieter. I was always shy and always had a way of like being quiet, but that made me so much more quiet. And then in high school, thank goodness freshman year, I found a group that was just, you know, we're all outsiders again, finally, just like I had normal. And then we found each other.
Did you move around a lot when you moved to high school? Were you a little bit more stable then?
No, stable in high school. Thank goodness I was there, the same place last 4 years.
All right. So the most difficult things that you experienced in high school?
Oh my goodness. Like, well, I guess it's trying to figure out who I am. I started like going from great grades to not so great grades, but it's like everybody else trying to figure out who you are and what, like what place and what purpose do you serve? But I was very thankful to have great, like see all the things that I've had was the loss of family, the crazies of like say family life where you always have a person who's just like the crazy one in family. But no, most of the stuff that happened was after the fact. Like say in high school, my dad, he got assaulted. It was, who knows, we say it might have been race. Who knows, maybe it's just a group of kids who just wanted to be awful people. But we had a Latin music store. Yeah. So my dad went to go get merchandise and my brother and I were partying. Not partying, like hardcore, it's high school. We were good kids, but at the same time going to like a Halloween party that was like really bad. We didn't tell our parents. And my dad said he was coming home and we thought, oh crap, we got to go back. We got to go back to the house. So we went back to the house, acted like, oh, we were here the whole entire time. And my dad comes through the door and he's gushing blood out of his head. And I started screaming and I saw my grandfather and he had his face bruised up and his mouth all swollen. And I didn't understand what happened. But he was driving from getting merchandise for the Latin music store. And apparently kids try to get into his car at a stoplight And my dad got out, like opened up the door. He shouldn't have opened up the door, but mm-hmm. he opened up the door to think like, hey, what's going on? And they just grabbed him and started beating him.
Oh, wow.
My grandfather went and he went to go cover him up. Like he covered him up to say, please stop. And then they started beating my grandfather.
Oh, wow.
And something like that, where I'm like, how do human beings act this way?
Yeah.
Why do they, like, I don't understand. So no matter what it is, I'm like, if they're trying to like be crazy, if it's out of race, if it's out of, because they just felt like it in the moment, I don't understand. But then when you come, like, I don't understand as it is. When right. I came to my grandfather, why would you do that to an old man?
Yeah.
Why would you do like, does that make you feel strong? Does that make you tough? Does it make you feel like you're in control of your life? That you don't do that.
Right.
He could have died.
Yeah. Yeah. What did that do? So when that happened, how did you process that? Like, did that leave any scarring on you?
Right. Not on how I interact with the world, but it made me so angry. Like, I think if any point in time, like if I ever felt like I wanted to hurt anybody, it would have been that time. Because I was so angry at what somebody did to my grandfather. Like, I was so angry. Like, I could understand, like, in a moment like that. Not that I would say, hey, somebody, it's okay to kill someone. Like, I would never say anything like that. Never.
Right.
Like, you should never, if you ever feel like anything like that, that's when you're like, okay, I need to do something to control my anger. Because even though anger is a normal feeling to have, it's yeah. not, we are highly, okay, we have functional brains, smart, highly functional brains that no other creature on this earth have, that we have this gift of having our brains to be able to tell us we should not do this action. We yeah. need to calm ourselves down, and anger is okay, but the way we react is totally different. So I understand, but at that point in time, I was like, I understand how a person could feel that enough anger to want to hurt someone.
Right. How did you stand down? How did you calm that anger? Do you remember?
To be there for my family. To yeah. be there for my family. Like we family units or friends, and family comes into all different forms. That's what I learned about life too. It's not always blood. It's also friends.
You got
friends.
It. Yep.
It's friends. And you can find that support, and you're around each other, and you help each other.
Yeah.
You help each other.
No, I love that.
This is Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
All right, guys, we're going to get right back to the show, but I want to first tell you about something that is so important. Okay, let's talk about this pandemic, because a lot of us are still in quarantine, but there's some people that are going to be out there. Overall, the number one thing that has been spoken about is about health. And COVID-19 has shown that it has really taken the lives of a lot of people that have had other underlying conditions, which means health is the number one thing you have got to control. The great thing is, it is the number one thing that you can control. And when I was looking for someone in the fitness world that I really believed in, I found RP Strength. I checked out their Instagram, which is just RP Strength, and it was phenomenal and incredible, the before and after pictures that I was finding. So I wanted to bring that to you. And they love the mission of Chasing Glory, so they wanted to partner. It's a win-win situation, and now we want to create a win-win for you. Guys, seriously, it's not just going to make you look good, it's going to make you feel good. Let me just tell you, very simply, go to rpstrength.com. Normally, their at-home workouts are $99, but right now, if you use the promo code Lilian20, and on top of the sale that they're already having, it comes down to $31 for all the templates. They have male, they have female templates. So you guys are both covered. It is so easy. It is great. You can do it in your balcony. You can do it in your living room. Sometimes I'll even put on a Netflix show while I'm working out. It's anything to get it in and have fun while you're doing it. And also at rpstrength.com, you can get the diet app. You can get one-on-one coaching. I'm telling you, everything is there. Everything you need to take control and put health number one and make it fun at the same time. All right, so just go to rpstrength.com, promo code Lilian20, LILIAN20. Take control right now. All right, back to the show.
Now more Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
Well, I mean, I appreciate you sharing that, because I like to talk, you know, obviously about the wins in life, but I also like to talk about the struggles, like I was asking you, because so many lessons are learned in the struggles, and so many things when they do happen, we can talk about it and help other people that might be struggling as well.
People think because they don't see struggles that everybody has their life together. And it's not, it's just talking about the struggles isn't the easiest thing.
I know.
It is. It's hard. It's hard to say, like, oh, either this has happened to me or I screwed up. It happens. Everybody screws up. Everybody makes mistakes.
Yeah.
That's okay. It's just what we do after it. It's like, okay. Even if you don't make the best choices and after the fact, it's okay.
Yeah.
As long as you realize, hey, we have choices. We can make it better. Things happen to each and every one of us. And it's, you know, you soak in it, you let it digest, you do what you need to do to be okay within yourself, and then you take action.
Yeah.
It's okay.
I agree. That's exactly why, you know, with this show, we get real, we get raw, we get right down to it, but then it becomes inspiring, because it is inspiring when you learn from all of that. I want to ask you, with WWE, your journey, looking back at your journey, we talked about the fact that you couldn't really, at the time, you didn't take the time to appreciate those wins. Do you know why? What was going on in your mind?
Well, just trying to survive each day. Like, I get, maybe I wondered, okay, so this is good, because this is all therapeutic for me. We're opening up here. Because I'm thinking, maybe I always was the weird kid that was out of place, because I was that when I was younger. As much as, like, I'm always happy and everything's great, in those moments, like, I was always the oddball, or things weren't always that great. I just wanted to go home. But I always had something positive to look at. My frame of mind as a kid. So for me, that's how I overcame depression and all this stuff, because I thought back, how did I react when I was a kid? How did I get through things as I was a kid? I was strong. How was a child strong? Mm-hmm. And as an adult, I should be able to be that person again. So it made me realize, like, okay, I want to be that happy. I want to be the child that found a way to overcome, to be like, okay, let's look on the bright side. Let's, you know, keep moving. So my child, the person that I was as a child, was actually strong, and I admire that ability. But sometimes throughout life we forget, because obviously, again, I was like the weird one out, and in wrestling I felt like I was the odd one out still, even though I found a group.
Do you know why you felt odd or weird out, you know, weird one out?
I think I took a little bit of blame, where I put myself in that position probably because that's what I'm used to. But also, we're in an environment that I see it now, and I don't think people realize that they put me in that position. But I think that sometimes people had to put up walls, shut people out, or maybe even get upset at somebody, because that's what they needed to do for themselves to get by. So I feel like sometimes I was a scapegoat sometimes, because it made somebody else feel like that's what they needed to do. They didn't make them bad people. It's what they needed to do for their ability to survive that environment. Because sometimes didn't make, like, that environment as great as it was, because it was great. I'm very appreciative for all the things, like experiences, moments, things we got to do, places we got to see. Like, as much as there were so many great things, there also we're all in a cage together. What happens when you put, like, what is it, mice? When you put mice in a cage that are too small for, like, they can't move around and breathe, they start eating each other, don't they? They start killing each other off or something.
I think so, yeah.
I feel like that's what we did unknowingly. We did that because it's just, there wasn't any break. We were in each other's face all the time. And so, but that's why I see you guys like my sisters. These are my sisters because you don't always get along. Sisters don't always get along.
Right.
But this, that's the way family is. Sometimes you butt heads. Sometimes you know, like, you share the best of moments.
Yeah.
But I know it was hard to understand each other's personality type. And I know if I didn't speak and tell you guys, like, how my personality was and how I, like, what I was thinking and how I reacted, you couldn't understand. So I do take blame in that, but I was so shy that I didn't know how to do that.
Yeah.
And then seeing in perspective of other people, and that's why they kind of like, they didn't want to open up to me because I was too nice, because I was fake. Sometimes I see that if you tell people your personal information, they sometimes use it against you. So you built up a wall gives you fear of letting person know everything about you, because then they use it for something like
that. Like what was used against you? Like,
thank goodness nothing bad, but I remember people were throwing in my face, like saying like, oh, well, you were married and da 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 da. Like, it's like, why would you even bring that up? Just to, because like, it was a moment where they wanted to make me cry. I was like, what? Why are you saying that? What does that have to do with anything?
Right.
Because like I was married, it's like young people being young.
Yeah.
Saying stupid things to each other, not having a true intention or not even having a resolution or a reason for why we are doing this.
Right.
It's like they didn't really bring up a scenario where it would, what was the purpose of bringing it up?
Yeah.
Nothing. Okay. But that's why, like, when I heard that, I was like, well, I told her about my wedding, me getting married. You didn't know about it. So that made me think you told her and she's telling her. And then it was all this crazy. I'm like, why is everybody saying stuff? Like, what does it matter what I did in my past and
right.
all this stuff? So that made me even closed off even more, where I'm like, I'm not going to talk to anybody.
I hear you.
What's going to happen if I say anything about anything? I also like, that's so weird.
Think about it too, because especially with WWE, right? It was more at the time, it was more about the men. It was less about the women. And when the women were on, it was one match, maybe. And it was 2 to 3 minutes, you're fighting for your spot. You've got all these women, they're fighting for your spot. So instead of being able to help each other, it's like you get into an environment and the perception, right? Your mentality is, I've got to just claw and I got to push. There's not enough room for everyone. And I got to claw and I got to claw. So we're learning that, right? As the more we talk about all of this, we're learning about what an environment like that will breed. I love the fact that it has really expanded and it's turned into what it has turned into and the space that women now have. You actually were part of, you know, we talk about now it being first ever Women's Royal Rumble and the Battle Royals and the, you know, the Elimination Chamber and all. But the fact that you had the first ever Women's Falls Count Anywhere match, dude, that's amazing.
Yes. Oh, I know. I love it. I'm very proud of that. I'm very excited. I was like, it's that added to like, these are my dreams coming true. Like, I can't believe that they trusted us with this. Part of me is like wished, because I was a manager for so long, that I wish that I reached the level of like deserving. Like, I wanted to be undeniable and amazing. Like, I wanted to be, to learn more. Cause I guess because I don't know, I had a level of what I wanted to be. And so for all of that to happen so fast, so soon, I thought I was undeserving. So in my mind, I was telling myself I was undeserving. But when I had the title, that's when I was like, no, I got to make this count. I got to make this mean something. Like, I need to step up. It wasn't about like there wasn't any worth in the title or anything like that. No, I know people twist words around. So that's why I like explain things, because I've experienced that too.
But tell me, what was misunderstood, so that if people don't know, you can go ahead and... And
that the title, when the way I said, I got to make this mean something, it didn't mean like the title. The title is already incredible. What I needed to make mean, like what the title run, me and my in that position, I need to make my time count and I need to step up to be better for the title, be better for the storyline, be better for the person that I'm working with. I needed to be better.
Right. So you're just encouraging yourself. And somebody took it completely out of context.
Yes. It tends to happen. I'm like, oh, just like recently on Twitter, I said, like, I can't do wrestling for very much longer. And everybody started taking it as, she's retired. Like, no, I didn't say I was retired.
But that does sound like that. So what does that mean? Because I would take it like that.
I just feel like I probably have like 1 or 2 years left in me. Like to do wrestling still. Like, I'll always be a part of wrestling somehow and go watch and maybe help if there's ever a place that needs my help.
Yeah.
And maybe manage, but I don't see myself like actually being in the ring for a long, like longer than
Is that because of your body, or is that because you're just a little burnt out?
Not both. Like you feel like,
yeah.
Times are changing. Things are different. And it's like, I was always a great character. And it's kind of hard because I'm such a baby face everywhere in the indies that I'm like, can't be a heel. I miss doing that. and everybody's doing flippy doos and like doing all this crazy stuff. And I was like, my body can't take that.
Yeah. How is your body doing after all these years wrestling?
Thank goodness. Knock on, let me find wood to knock on, but knock on wood, it's not bad. Like I don't have as much pain in my ankle when I had the ankle surgery.
Yeah.
So I have the 2 plates and 6 screws in my ankle. That used to hurt a lot, but now through therapy and moving my ankle around and everything, it's actually, I feel a lot better. But my knee is the one that's killing me. So my knees, sometimes they start clicking and yeah. They're weird. So I got to make sure to not do crazy stuff because I dislocated it 2 years ago too. So I'm like, okay, not as young as I used to be.
Right. What? Let me ask you this. Your transition from WWE into the real, back into the real world. How was that for you?
Thank goodness it wasn't as hard as it was I've seen some people go through, because through the injuries, I think the injuries were what actually helped me, because going home and being at home for all that time and being with my family puts me in check. They're like, you're still Melina. You're still, you know, PJ's little sister. He makes sure to keeps me in check. He humbles me all the time, but in the most loving way. Thank goodness I have a really great brother. But it being around family and everything kept me like okay about being normal and being humble and, you know, down to earth.
And like Melina, I was just going to say, hold that thought. And I would say too, because this is kind of what I stress, that you are not, Melina is not wrestler. You happen to do that as a job, but that's not who you are.
Yes. And that's really important for me because I think, that need, when I was Melina the wrestler, people never saw Melina.
Right.
So it was kind of like a blur where, you know, especially being a heel, everybody hated me. Like I felt like people could say like an expression like the world hates you. But in that point in time, the wrestling world hated me. Yeah. Everybody, whether they were in Italy or the UK, Australia, China, the world hated Melina. So it was like it was hard because nobody saw the Melina Perez Melina. So when people would meet me, they'd assume, oh, you're just a bitch.
Oh, you mean afterwards?
A shady ass bitch. Yeah, during and then afterwards too.
Yeah.
Like even now, I think sometimes some promotions might not hide, like they don't actually contact me because they're afraid. They're like, oh, is she a diva? Because I've heard she's a diva. There's so many crazy rumors where it's like, I asked for first class and I asked for this and I asked for all this. I'm like, no, I don't ask for all these things. I just want to be a part of wrestling. Like, that's not me. But people believed in the dirt sheets. They believed in the rumors. They believed in like the persona.
Yeah.
The persona that.
So what about the fact that you haven't been asked to be in the Royal Rumble or Evolution or anything like that that's happening? I mean, how has that made you feel? And can you process maybe why you haven't been asked?
Well, what I've learned through wrestling, like being in it or being in the WWE, was that when we were in it, we would always think the same thing. Like, why aren't we doing this storyline? Why are the girls not able to have this kind of match? Why is this, like, there were so many whys that at a certain point, I'm like, you know what? Why am I doing this to myself? I can't ask the whys because I'm going to drive myself crazy. So I learned that there's usually no rhyme or reason. There's nothing specific. It's just whatever's going on in that moment that they're doing whatever that they're doing. Mm-hmm. So I can't drive myself crazy wondering why. It just is what it is. So when I see the Royal Rumble, I learned to develop this also, this thing where I laugh at everything. So when I hear that, I'm like, I don't know. Like, I just laugh and I think, it is what it is. But I do admit, like, there's a little part of me that thinks, like, that would have been nice. Like, I would like to think or feel that I was a part of you know, creating or help maintain. Like, I felt like our generation, like the diva era, we kept it together when everybody hated us, when everybody kept saying, oh, well, this is a pee break, or this is a bathroom break and whatnot. Yeah. Like, people were mean. They wouldn't give us a chance, even if we wrestled our hearts out. We gave our all in an era where people just refused, because what I feel like is when Trish and Lita left, there was a backlash because their favorite people left. And I can blame them. Like, you know, that was painful. It's kind of like when, okay, Game of Thrones,
yeah,
the last episode happened, everybody's angry, and no matter what they made the last final
episode, I was not happy.
But if you think about it, Lilian, if you think about it, no matter what they created, no matter what they wrote,
yeah,
everybody was going to be angry. Yeah, everybody's going to hate it, because right, it's the fact that your favorite show is ending.
Yeah.
So right, so there's no way. There's just no way of doing something the way everybody wanted it. People are just going to be angry because it's the last show.
Yeah.
So the same with when Lita and Trish left. No matter what happened, no matter what era it was, even if they had every woman being badass wrestler, having every feeling, every spot, people would still hate it because their favorite people aren't there anymore. So there was going to be a backlash no matter what. So we kept it together. When people were angry, when people booed us, we kept it together. And we made people love watching. I still see women still trying to be divas, whether they're like, no, I'm a female wrestler. Like, I still see you trying to be a diva.
Yeah.
I don't care what you say. I still see you trying to be a diva, and that's okay.
There's so it didn't bother you. It in the diva era didn't bother you at all.
No. It was beautiful. Like, I still tell people to this day, like, the girls I work with had heart. You know what I mean? Like, they didn't have to try. They didn't have to go and either train, or because they wanted to train. They wanted to learn. They listened. They had passion.
Yeah.
There's some people who have a lot of training and they're gifted athletically, but they don't have the passion that these girls did.
Mm-hmm.
They have all the, I give them all the credit in the world. And people want to get upset, like, oh, well, they could have been a spot that somebody else. Well, it could have, but the WWE gave them a contract. And it's not their fault for accepting that contract. They'd be crazy not to, you know what I mean? No, give anybody a contract and say, here, you want to work for the WWE? And not everybody, but most cases, people will be like, yeah, I don't care. Just, I want to be a part of that. Yeah.
Right.
Can't blame them for that. That's an opportunity.
Right.
And they did the best in their position.
Yes, I totally agree. Sometimes,
I don't blame them at all. But they went in there and they stepped in the ring. They didn't have to. They could have denied it. They could have declined it. But they're like, no, I want to learn.
So let me ask you this. Because when you don't get asked to come back for Evolution or Royal Rumble or anything like that, the internet wants to say you've got heat with the WWE. I want you to be the one to say yay, nay, or what the deal is, or if you know, or what. Just set the story straight on your end.
Well, I always tell people, I'm like, I couldn't imagine having heat because I was like, I did everything I was told. I was a good employee. Like, I was like, But then at the same time, that's giving me too much credit, where I'm like, I did something awful. Like, okay. It's intriguing because I remember back in the day, people would say, like, I got people fired. And I was like, I can't even keep my own job. How am I going to, like, get people fired? And if I had that kind of stroke, like, wouldn't I, like, get, this ultimate storyline that's undeniable that would keep me in wrestling forever? You know what I mean? I'm like,
well, yeah.
So the heat thing, I'm like, I don't know if me – I can't speak for anybody, but I don't think so. Like, I couldn't imagine. I did everything I was told. They were nice to me when they let me go.
I was going to say, what was that conversation as to why they let you go?
A creative had nothing for me.
Okay.
I was like, Melina, I'm Melina. But granted, that's what I thought. I was like, I'm Melina. Of course, you could create for Melina. She could do anything. But at the same time, I knew there was a sense of relief. I was relieved when I got let go. And it's nothing like against WWE where, you know what I mean? What happened was I was injured twice. I never really took time off, real time off. And throughout the things I've been through, like, I needed to get my mind straight. I needed peace. I needed to just take a break. And I told them, they asked me, they're like, why aren't you crying? Because apparently I cry all the time because I'm like, oh no.
Yeah, you do cry a lot.
Oh, no, I'm going to this. I think I'm sensitive.
Yeah, that's okay. That's okay.
And so when I didn't cry, they asked me, like, you're not going to cry? I was like, no. Because I really did believe, like, you see, being in the business, you see people leave, come back, leave, come back. So I said, I know there'll be a time where I come back. Like, it's not the end. So I was secure in that, knowing that wasn't the end.
But the fact that you haven't come back, now has that been one of those, well, maybe you don't come back. Are you okay with not coming back?
I'm okay. Like, yeah. Because and maybe that plays a factor, I don't know. But I'm secure in what I've done. And regardless if I've come to terms, like, I guess back then before people started to acknowledge me, because it's not until recently people were looking back at videos and matches that I've had and actually really appreciating them or being able to be open about it, because it was taboo to like Melina. And now people are starting to see it and like it, and it makes me, when people tell me I'm going to be in the Hall of Fame and whatnot, I tell them it's okay if I'm not. Like, I saw China, and China, she deserved to be in it, and she wasn't in it for so long that I'm like, see, that's proof right there that even a person who's deserving, like, it's not, I knew she was supposed to be in there, but she wasn't. Mm-hmm. And it's okay. Because I'm not in there doesn't mean I wasn't deserving. I was secure in what I've accomplished. And Melina, the human being Melina, will survive regardless.
Yeah.
It's a hard thing to be like, there's everybody, sometimes when your TV or wrestling persona is no longer valued, it kind of hurts a person's ego and how they carry themselves in the real life. And I know that's painful, but I realized, I'm like, you know what? I'm still okay. I'm still Melina. I'm still strong. I'm still creative. I'm still happy. And that's the part I needed to find, was to find that happiness and that value outside of the ring.
But that's the part that I always say is sometimes the hardest, is the transition. It's the same thing as a regular person goes off and becomes a soldier. And
yes,
then there are times.
I tell people that too. PTSD. There is
you
PTSD
got
it. In
it. You got
how
it.
Do
you come
how
back
do you
into reality.
Just regular life. When people
again.
See you as normal, when I do admit that I'm okay being me outside regular life, but where it does affect me, where, because I tell people, a lot of people are like, I'm sorry, I don't know who you are. And people think I'm going to get offended to that. Or when people who are wrestlers don't know who I am, and then other people are like, come on, like, that's disrespectful. I say, it's okay. I don't mind. Because, yeah. You know, if they don't know, they don't know. It
right.
doesn't offend me. It doesn't hurt me. I don't get angry. I'm like,
right.
No, it's okay. Because I'm used to it now. But I do see how, like, sometimes it's like, ooh, it hurts. But where it affects me is relationship-wise. It's hard. Like, I'm single, everybody. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it does affect me where I try to be normal. And then to deny that you used to be a wrestler and that you are these things, it's like, well, I'm not normal. I'm all these things wrapped up into one. So it is hard to adjust of, like, who you were and who you are now. And you have to come to terms with, I'm all of it at once, even if I'm a part of that still or not.
Yeah. Do you feel that, you know, you had a relationship with John Morrison and then you had a relationship with Batista. So do you feel like they understood you because it was, they were in the, you know, you guys are in the same field? And
yes,
it's hard now to maybe date somebody that's outside of wrestling, or is it, are you looking to try to date
no matter what
wrestling?
It is. No, I guess I just trying to find somebody who's understanding for everything, me as a human being. Because dating somebody within wrestling, yeah, they understand wrestling, but at the same time, they don't understand, or at back then, there wasn't an understanding of what you go through as a female in the female locker room, or in the female wanting a certain kind of storyline or what you're trying to accomplish. There's still a disconnect. because they're going through what they go through in their world. Yeah. And when we were going through what we went through in our world. And so there's, and this is all relationships across the board. So whether it's a person who's in wrestling or a person outside of wrestling, there's always going to be, you know, there are plus and minuses. There are positive and negatives.
Yeah.
So there's always going to be that. But you would think that dating a person outside of wrestling, they accept you for who you are. And there's this home life where you get to unwind and disconnect and recharge. But at the same time, a person outside of wrestling is always worried about who you interact with inside of wrestling. And then there's the insecurities and them not understanding what you go through. It's just finding, whether it's in wrestling or outside, there's no better what's better or not. It's just finding that one person that understands both.
Right, right. Now, you touched on the fact that you had suffered depression. Was that early on?
Through,
because I like to talk about mental health and the fact that it is so prevalent and people don't want to talk about it. And I think we need to talk about it.
Yeah, definitely. Because I've heard stories of people, their traumas and depression started when they were younger because they've been either abused or bullied and gone through stuff in life as a child. So that became their foundation. Mm-hmm. Or for me, what happened is, even though I went through hardships and our family went through struggles, and it never affected me because I had my family.
Right.
And because emotionally, I thought like I was strong. I felt strong. I felt confident. I felt like I knew what I wanted and how to act because what my family taught me. But my traumas came later on in life because going from my family who I trusted, and I thought in wrestling, everybody was my family. And I trusted, it kind of made me naive and vulnerable in a sense where like you don't realize you trust the wrong people. Mm. And that's everyone across the board. It's not just me, like, oh, just me. But sometimes you trust the wrong people and you think that they have your best interests at heart. And then really they just abuse that and take advantage of your trust or their position.
Right.
So for me, when it came to my form of bullying or my form of like, let's shut her out and all this stuff, it was harder for me because I kept thinking, I'm an adult. This shouldn't be this shouldn't be happening. We're adults and this is our job. And why is all these things happening? So me feeling like I never belonged, no one seeing me for who I am, because people don't realize that I was reading some stuff when it came to depression, of how people see people in television, and it's like, why? You have money, you're on TV, you know you have friends, you have everything that you could want. And I remember having my brother tell me that. He was never mean about it, but he would tell me, you have everything, why would you even think about, ever have your mind think about wanting to commit suicide? And he said, that's the problem right there. Everyone thinks I have everything and I don't. You know, you have people who, you know, you don't have great relationships. You have relationships. So thank goodness, like, you have relationships that fail, and not just fail, you get cheated on or whatnot. You think there's something wrong with you. Then me, I also experienced a sexual assault. And then, so that plays a part. And you think, what's wrong with you? People don't see that you're suffering and they just dismiss it because apparently money and being in the public eye means that you have support and you don't. You don't know who to trust because sometimes people just want to be your friend because you're a name.
Yeah.
And then it's like you're seen by everyone, but no one sees you.
Yeah.
And no one listens to you. Like, you could openly say, I'm hurting. And they're like, yeah, whatever. And then that's even more lonely. That makes you more, because I just said, I'm hurting and you just dismissed it.
Right.
So then you seclude yourself and then you put a bigger wall. And then you meet people that you think like, oh, they're acting in your own best interest, and then they hurt you, and then that builds another wall. You're even lonelier because you don't know who to trust. You don't know what's real and what's not real.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's even lonelier. No matter how much money you got or how many people are following you on Instagram or Twitter.
Well, dude, I mean, they talk about the fact that, you know, the rich, I mean, like the really rich, some of the highest suicide rates are the most wealthiest people. I think it's because they also probably find out, they get there, they make the money, they're still unhappy, and they go, holy cow, we worked all this hard, and we thought that that meant happiness. Having a certain amount of money meant happiness. They find out that, no, that does not mean happiness. So therefore, everything is gone from my perception of what life is, and therefore, I'm going to take my life. Now, thank God, what has stopped you from not, first of all, thank you for being so open about the sexual assault, and as far as I know, you just touched on it, but, and then, you know, thinking about committing suicide.
It's taken years to be able to talk about it. So I always tell people, when you realize this is going on, don't worry about what everybody else is going to think. Just think, what can I do for myself to make myself better, or to help me get through this?
Right.
That's the main priority. Don't think about everybody else. Don't think about what everybody's going to say, how everybody's going to react. How can I help myself to make it through this?
Right.
That's the important part. So when it comes to, like, to me, the assault and the depression, the suicide is like two different things to touch base on and how to deal with it, or possibilities. But what happened for me was more somebody caught me before anything happened to me. So when that happened, it was like a grace of God where I, like, you know, somebody like I cared about walked in and found me.
Where were you? Can you take me back? Because I don't know the complete story on this at all.
Yeah, I don't really open up and like talk about it, because one, I don't want people to imitate it and recreate it, because it's like I don't want people to say, like, to do that action.
I love that. Yeah, please don't. But was it before WWE?
No, it was during.
Oh, okay, got it.
So I think yeah, it was so long ago. I think it was during my injury, my leg injury, where all this stuff was going on, and then I'm not wrestling. Like, what, I just, all of a sudden, I hated life. When it comes to depression, when it comes to thinking about suicide, it's a series of events. It's not something that just happens. It's a series of, not just series of events, but also a series of things you tell yourself. And you don't think, everyone's like, why can't people think of who they're affecting they're affecting everybody around them, and they get so angry about that. You think about the people around you, and you tell yourself you're better off, or they're better off without you. A lot of times the people who care and have the biggest hearts are the ones that say, well, everybody's lives would be better if I wasn't here. And not only you have your emotional suffering, you're living your personal hell in your mind. You don't know how to get out of it. But when you think about your family, you think they'll be fine. They'll be fine. And so it's all this emotional breakdown until you realize, you think in your mind, it's time. I can't do this anymore. And when I got found, I was like, why? Like, it was more like, what's going on than why? And I'm like, oh, I can't, I got, like, I'm fucking everything up. I even fucked this up. Like, this couldn't even happen to me. So it was just like, I was so upset. But then at the same time, it's like, okay, after years, it's like, why am I still here? Kind of like a little form of survivor's guilt, where it's kind of like, why am I still here when there's other people not here that should be here with us? So I would just, trying to find purpose of why do I exist? And I keep thinking that either part of it's my soul thinking, well, like, it's part in me to not give up, or I have a purpose here that I need to do something to help other people. Like, why does all these things happen to me? Because another thing that people tell me, it's like, what doesn't kill you make you stronger. Yeah. It's like, why do all these bad things have to happen for me to be stronger?
Right.
And then I thought, wow, I have an ability to be able to understand people, to relate to people, to tell them that everything's going to be okay. I now have gone through things that if I didn't go through it, I wouldn't understand anybody else. Like, when it came to, like, the rape too, I'm such a horrible, like, I admit I was a horrible person in the sense of, I heard stories of this one girl that I met. I remember meeting her, and she got she was raped multiple times. And I'm like, how the hell does that happen? Like, how is that a person who doesn't understand,
right?
Like being ignorant, like, I'm like, I can't relate. I just couldn't relate because how does that happen? My brain couldn't wrap my head around that.
Yeah.
And then, so for me, I've it's happened to me more than once. And then when it happened, it's just like, I put me in a deeper depression because it's like, how does that happen? Now I was like looking at myself thinking, how does that happen? How did you let that happen? Mm. Like that, oh, but now I understand what she went through. And it's like, if that didn't happen to me, then I wouldn't be able to help others who that's happened to because they need somebody to relate to them.
Yeah.
So they don't face, because I do want to eventually go back to school, because I did go to school for a little while for psychology, but eventually I want to definitely go back to finish it up. I want to do psychology so I can be a therapist, so then I can help others. Because a person who hasn't gone through it, I mean, I know. Not that they're incapable of it. It's not that they're incapable of helping, but a person who understands because they've been through it helps so much more. Yeah. It's like going to AA and, you know, your sponsor is somebody who's already been through it and they've been sober for so many years. Right. That helps a lot more than a person who's never understood it.
Yeah.
So that's why I keep thinking this probably all happened to me because I can help somebody else. I can tell them it's okay.
Again, I thank you for talking about it because it is your strength right now that someone's listening to this going, oh my gosh, she's saving me. She's saving me just from hearing this. Melina.
Thank you.
No,
but I want people to know it can get better.
Yeah.
And a lot of times people say, and I wrote that in a tweet or in a post, and I was trying to tell people depression, sometimes like it's something either that's there, something that like, it, no matter what it is, whether it's, they call it like a disease, like it could be no matter what it is that it's there. And there's nothing you can do about it. Once it's in, like creeps up in you, it's there. Mm-hmm. But I do believe we do have a choice. You can't choose like in a sense of like, oh, today I choose to be happy and all of a sudden I am. No, you have to work at it.
Yeah.
But you have to choose to want to work at it.
Right.
You have to choose that I'm okay. I hurt today, but I choose to get up out of bed. That's my first step. My first job is I'm getting out of bed.
Yeah.
I'm going to open up the windows. All these little things, it takes time. It might take years. But once you start finally understanding that the way I react and what I do to surround myself with positivity, that's going to be worth it.
Yeah.
That's going to be worth it. And you will live a life appreciating everything that much more. Like right. Because of all the darkness that I've seen, and the negativity that I've seen and felt, now I like food tastes so much sweeter.
Yeah.
You know, everything, like I look at the sky and I'm like, God, it's beautiful. Like I take the time to go into nature and be able to look and go to the beach and look at the sunset and the sunrise. It's so much beautifuler. And I see that I am lucky to be able to see this.
Yeah.
I'm lucky because there's some people out there, they didn't want to, you know, die early, but they did.
Wow.
And I got to celebrate for them.
That's the thing I was going to say is we're in a time right now being so sad about Ashley. So sad.
Yeah. And it breaks my heart because, you know, I know like, I have to tell myself there's nothing, cause I will dwell on it forever. And I know that it's not, there's nothing, there could have been something, but at this point, there's nothing I can do. But then I think, oh man, if I would have messaged more, like
we've all said that, right? But we didn't know. We didn't know. When you don't know, you don't know. I mean, the beautiful thing.
I wish I could have told her that. I understand. I understand.
Yeah. You know, the beautiful thing or the silver lining of it is, and Michelle McCool and I were talking about this last week, is talking about how we've now started that thread with all the, you know, squared circle sisters, and we're all communicating with each other and saying, hey, we're here. You have any problems, anything, just, you know, we're here for each other and, you know, reach out. And it is a beautiful, it's a support system. It's a support system that we really didn't have before. And that sometimes our own family doesn't understand, you know, what our journey has been, you know, in this job or any job that we would have been together. Right. Yeah. So I say
that's like, how do you tell people when you're, say, like for us in our group?
Yeah.
It's like when you're going through relationships and everything, having kids and not having kids and our dogs, like all these different things. It's just living life, being what we were and being in WWE, being a wrestler. And only we can understand each other because we've seen each other through all of it.
Right.
And I'm glad that we got close to each other. And, you know, of course, it's sad that Ashley didn't get to see that. But at the same time, it's like such a blessing because this whole entire time, like, I never got to express all the things that I felt. Like, I told Tori, I said, you don't understand. Like, I looked up to you. I watched her in WCW. I watched everybody. So yeah. I never said that in wrestling, like, told everybody how I looked up to them, how I admired them, how I respected them, how I was proud of them. Like, I know Ashley knew, but I wish I would have told her recently. Like, I was proud of her.
Yeah.
I was proud of her. I was proud of everybody. So to be able to say that now helps me so much because in my mind I thought, oh, well, I don't belong still. Even to this day, I felt like I didn't belong.
Really?
But that thread, us coming together, it's like, okay, now I'm not going to waste time not telling you guys how I feel.
Because you do belong.
I love you. You're an angel.
Oh, man. You made me cry. Seriously. No, I love you too. Like, it really has been a hard time, but it really has been a beautiful thing to come together, you know? And so I say that to people is you have to create a support system. You have to. Even if it's your neighbor, you know, some guy that you see every day at the store. Let's just say that somebody out there is feeling very lonely right now because they say, I don't have family around me that is very supportive. I don't have, you know, neighbors, or I don't have my, I'm necessarily maybe working at home. So I don't have a job that I can, you know, have a bonding with other people that work there. So what about if you go every day to the 7-Eleven and you see the guy at the 7-Eleven every morning? Let's just say that, right? And you say good morning every day to him. How about next time start a conversation with him to get to know him a little bit? Because next thing you know, you can actually start creating a bond with this person. Next thing you know, you can say, hey, you want to go grab a beer down the street, you know, whatever. And and the next thing you know, you start that and you get to know. And this is what's been the beautiful thing, right, about doing the show. I now know more about you and the way you grew up. I understand you better. And I think that's the main thing. That was the purpose of this, is to understand each other better. Because when you do, I can see when you're shy now, I could see that you are that younger girl. You've been put in all of these different schools, and now you're trying to make new friends and you're trying to, you know, fit in again. And all of a sudden you go into middle school and you're not fitting in and everyone's telling you you don't belong and you can't even find dolls that look like you. Oh, of course. All of this stuff, of course. Now you're feeling like the ugly duckling. And now someone tells you at work, wow, you're very standoffish. They have no idea all the stuff that you keep telling yourself, all the things that you've been through. Your whole life is playing and rewind in your mind. And they're not in you. They don't know everything you've been through. They don't understand your silence. So that's why
everybody we interact with. That's exactly why everybody's so quick to judge nowadays and just assume.
Right. And
everybody wants the same things. Everybody wants happiness and everybody wants love. Everybody wants to be a part of something. Everyone.
Tribe. We all are longing for tribe. It's going back to the cave days when the cavemen, all of that, they always had a tribe. They were around the fires in a tribe. Tribes are very important, feeling like you belong to something. But sometimes you have to be the one to step out, to be the one to create that belonging even for someone else, which is why I was saying, who knows if you're the person that goes into that 7-Eleven and you start befriending that guy at the counter, that guy at the counter, you don't know that they are thinking, I have no friends, I have no purpose, I have nothing, right? So now you're the ones that's creating that bond to say, look, let's try to form a friendship here. And if for some reason that person is shy or cool, whatever, go to the next person, you know, or give them a little bit more time to come out of their shell. Because you don't know what they're going through.
Yes.
So.
Exactly. I always try my best to like always smile. Well, okay. So the way I got through everything, like, okay, so this is what I implore people. Like, if you're a, because I, what happened to me is I being very quiet, very shy, stubborn too, in the fact of like, I do not want to be a burden to anybody else.
Yeah.
So me, because I went, I got better and then hit another form of depression. When I got raped again and everything, then everything started falling apart. I didn't want to leave the house. I was always worried about, you know, who's like, what's going to happen. I couldn't socialize because I kept thinking, if I'm in certain, like, no matter what scenario, what if something happens? What if this happens? And you never, like, I was paranoid, scared, really couldn't trust people. I felt like, you know, relationships fail. I, again, started wanting to die. I couldn't get up out of bed in the morning. And the only, like, I didn't have my family because my family didn't understand anything I was going through. And if anything, it would make me feel bad to tell my family and then break their hearts or be a disappointment and whatnot. I already didn't, like, I didn't really have friends because sometimes when you have relationships, you push people away.
Yeah.
Like, that's, I'm big on my family and friends nowadays because I never want to push my friends away again. Not for any, like, if a I want a relationship where they embrace my friends. They don't take me away from my friends.
Right.
And like, we all need to be together. And
that's another huge lesson right there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so I was alone. I was alone, depressed, and my dog saved my life. Like, he was the reason why I got up in the morning. Cause I would look at, like, I would drink myself to oblivion. I would pray that maybe I'll have a heart attack. Maybe I'll die. Maybe this, like, I'd say crazy ass things to myself in my head thinking, I just wish it would all end. And because I didn't, I was in my head, I told myself I was a coward for not trying to commit suicide again. Like, I hated my life, like, in my mind. And I look at my dog's face and he didn't understand what was going on. He'd just get closer and closer and think, like, look at me, like, with concern. And then I'd look at that little face and think, well, I don't deserve you. And like, okay, like the way I was with that title, I got to be worthy of you. Like, that little face depended on me and I needed to be what he needed me to be. So then it was just little steps. Got to get up. Got to take him out. I got to walk him. He needs to smile.
Yeah.
And then I remember Dave, like, so Batista told me, he's like, Melina, he would tell me all the time, go outside and share your smile with the world. And that's why I say that all the time. You tell me that. He told me, share your smile with the world. It's like, oh, fine. So then I remember him telling me that. So then I was like, okay, go outside. You know, like, see how Charlie Bear would, like, make everybody smile. And then I'd smile too. And then it was just little steps. Like, nobody could save me because I had to change myself. There was nobody who was going to be the one to change my life, to make me happy again. It wasn't going to be like a relationship. Some man going to save me. No, it wasn't going to be my family because my family doesn't understand. Right. I had to change how I saw the world.
Right.
I paint my walls to be a brighter color, a happier color. Instead of listening to sad songs, I changed the songs. Everything had to be positive. And if I didn't believe it, you know, I'd be like, at least I'm listening to it. And then eventually in time, everything, if the way I got up in the morning, if this t-shirt made me smile, it's a good thing. Yeah. Everything had to be specific that, does this make me smile? TV show, does this make me smile? If it doesn't make me smile, I had to say goodbye. And sadly, even if it was friends, I tell them, I love you. You're a great person, but your energy and what you bring me in my life, it's hurting me. It makes me feel like I want to hurt myself. So I had to say goodbye to people. And there's nothing wrong with them. I love them and I hope they know that I love them. Yeah. But they're just like, I couldn't, it was too hard for me to be around them.
Well, you got to protect your environment. Yeah. That's a big thing. You have to protect your environment.
I had to protect here and here.
Yeah.
So then I could be better for other people.
Yeah. I love the fact that you're going to soon find the, you know, the closure for wrestling, but know that that doesn't mean that Melina's gone. And I love that you know where you're going now in the therapy and you know, being a therapist and all and helping people. I think it's a beautiful thing. What a journey you've had. Holy moly. I want to ask you as we wrap this up, I mean, it's been fascinating. And again, I thank you so much for being so open. Has your chase for glory looked the way you thought it was going to look?
No, none of it. But then at the same time, it's because like you're unaware. You think it's one thing. And the reality is you can't foresee all the other, you know, factors in life, all the other things that come along with it. There's some people who say like, I didn't sign up for people being in my face. And I get that. I didn't sign up for you. I just thought I was going to be a part of this beautiful, you know, thing called wrestling. And I didn't expect people to be in my face and to judge me and to want to pick apart every little thing I do. I didn't sign up for it, but I had to come to terms with this is what comes along. And it was hard. It was a hard reality to face. It took years. It wasn't instantaneous, but I realized I have to accept all these things that come with it. And it's not fair sometimes. It sucks, but I have to understand that this is what came with it.
Yeah.
I just wasn't aware. It was just,
and that's even fans. You know, we do, that's even fans, because we have put ourselves out there. And there's some fans that can be so cruel with their message.
You give them a little and they want more. And it's like, I'm giving everything that I can. Like, and you're getting too intrusive.
And or the comments.
They don't understand. The comments that they make and everything. And with, like, I've seen the things. I want to, before we wrap up at all, I do want to, like, say, mention about everybody getting help and going to any hotline and trying to seek help.
Absolutely.
Before we get to that, I want to also, when it comes to Ashley, so I saw a thread that said about Ashley. I didn't know if anybody knew what happened to her because they were holding it for so long, like saying nobody talked about it. So I thought, well, maybe it's something that's not going to be talked about. But now that it's out there, I saw a thread and it was so mean. It was so mean. And granted, I know that's only the negative part of it. Like sometimes the people who talk are just the people who are just wanting to say mean things.
Yeah.
And there's thousands and millions of positive people out there.
Yes.
Who support and love Ashley and know who she was truly.
Yes.
And see her for who she is or who she was. But the thread was so mean. Like, oh, why would you do that? Like, as if they were picking on her that she had money, she had this, she was beautiful. Oh, this is just another person who just couldn't accept that they had it all and all that.
Oh,
I'm like, that's
God.
So the mean things that were said. I was like, how could you guys? That's so mean. You know, she sacrificed her body in the ring to entertain you guys because
right.
She loved you guys. She loved you.
Right.
How can you say such mean things? And stuff like that is just like, this, you don't get it. And you know what? I forgive you for not understanding, but at the same time, I hope one day you realize that you shouldn't be saying that. That's awful.
Well, that's the thing.
That's
I hope
awful.
That people wake up, right? That people will look at that one day and go, what the hell was I thinking? Why did I say this? And really analyze where that was coming from. Because I don't think people are mean sometimes because they just want to be mean.
They just don't understand.
They either don't understand or they're in their own pain, right? They're in their own thing. That's why a lot of times I'm like, okay, I can't right now be angry at you because you're obviously doing this to lash out because you're in your own world, right? So it has really nothing to do with me because you're doing it. Even if anybody in my position, you'd be saying it, right? So that's the one thing. Yeah, for sure. I want to say
suffering comes in all different levels. It comes from all different levels and people perceive heartache. Some are more sensitive than others. Yes. But for me, like my sensitivity, I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world because I love so much more and I feel happiness that much more. I just need to talk to myself in my head when it comes to those sad moments where it's like, okay, Melina, understand, like, it's going to be okay. Like, this will pass. It'll pass.
Yeah.
But you know, it's a skill to be able to do that for yourself. And until you realize that you have control over those thoughts, it's painful, but pain is perceived no matter if you have money, if you don't have money, even if, because sometimes people are like, oh, let's compare traumas. Well, it's not about that.
Right.
A person who's never experienced the worst things in the world, they still experience depression in their mind, through their eyes. That hurts.
Right.
So please be understanding. Just because it wasn't as bad as what you've been through doesn't make it less painful. Nah,
exactly. Like,
so yeah, you have to be understanding to everybody's struggles, everybody's journey.
Right. And go ahead and tell your information for the hotlines.
Yeah, so everybody, you can go to, it's on my Instagram, and I'm bad with numbers, so I apologize. I should be better at this.
No, but let's go, which one you wanted to give the hotline for, because I want to go ahead and is it for suicide hotline?
Yeah, the suicide hotline.
So it's 1-800-273-8255. 1-800-273-8255. That's the National Suicide Prevention line. So please, if you're anywhere thinking, contemplating, even if it's just in your thoughts, call so that you can get help so that you don't spiral downward even more.
Yeah, catch this before it gets to worse. That point.
Exactly. Yes. Melina, thank you.
I love you.
I love you so much. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Oh, thank you for having me.
This is Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
Thank you so much for watching. Make sure you guys subscribe to this channel so that you don't miss a single video or a live stream. And definitely share this with a friend. All right, follow the show at Chasing Glory on Instagram, at Lilian Garcia on Instagram and Twitter, and Lilian Garcia official fan page on Facebook. For everything Chasing Glory, just go to chasingglory.com. Until next week, go out there and live with much peace, love, and passion. And remember, always be yourself and trust that it's enough. Mwah. See you guys. Bye.
Thanks for joining us here on Chasing Glory from executive producer Lilian Garcia.